tongue and hold my breath. Scared to rock the boat and make a mess. So I said quietly, agreed politely. I guess that I forgot I had a choice. I let you push me past the breaking point. I stood for nothing, so I fell for everything. You held me down, but I got up. Already brushing off the dust. You hear my voice, you hear that sound. Like thunder gonna shake the ground. You held me down, but I got up. Get ready, cause I've had enough. I see it all, I see it now. I got the eye of the tiger. Stinging like a bee, I earned my stripes. I went from zero to my own hero. You held me down, but I got up. Already brushing off the dust. You hear my voice, you hear that sound. Like thunder gonna shake the ground. You held me down, but I got up. Get ready, cause I've had enough. I see it all, I see it now. I got the eye of the dog.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Kasturi from Unilever Food Solutions, which is a business built by chefs. So we know what you face every day in the kitchen. Everything we do is focused on making your life a bit easier. Our presenter today is the Culinary Chef Experience Advisor of Unilever Food Solutions, KZN, Chef Mary Worthington. Today, Chef Mary Worthington will be joined by Chef Trevor. Mental Health Month is a welcome opportunity for everyone associated with the food service industry to consider the role they play in contributing to a happy and supportive kitchen culture. Chef Mary and Chef Trevor will be discussing how you can support your team members who are struggling with their mental health. Just a little housekeeping before we get started. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the question box. Chef will answer them after the presentation. Chef will also be running a short poll during a session, and we would really appreciate your participation. Now, without any further ado, we'll turn our time over to Chef Mary.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining the webinar today. Nice to see that there's so many people on the line. Welcome to Chef Trevor, General Manager of Operations, Food and Beverage for City Lodge Hotel Group. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you so much for coming to chat to the hospitality industry on the topic of mental well-being. If I could just ask you to share some of your life experiences today, that would be great.
Good morning, everybody. We don't have much time and I've got lots to talk about. I suppose the first thing I'd want to start about is saying that I would possibly be the last person I thought that would be, talking about this. I was guilty, I suppose, of my whole career falling in the trap of just being okay, whether you're not okay, nothing to worry about, just get on with it. Do your job today, get over it, and come back tomorrow. So, guilty as charged. until I suppose this little word with five letters, is it five letters, COVID, kind of interrupted my life. Coming back from the Culinary Olympics in 2020, I was kind of riding a wave of almost immortality in my career. Things were going well. I had a fantastic job. I just finished the fourth Olympics that I'd been to. I was managing the team at the Culinary Olympics in Stuttgart, came back, and look, the story of COVID was happening around us, but we were in Africa, it was never going to touch us. And having been in Europe, I was in Germany and Paris, and 3 weeks later, the hotel that I worked at the Michelangelo closed down, and I suppose changed my life dramatically. And that was where I had to get into the point of, I suppose, starting to have a little discussion with myself. And it became tough, eh? Losing everything, this time not my own fault. Having to understand that you're fighting for survival. And kind of that thing affected me heavily. Not even being offered a job in 13 months was, you never thought as a chef you'd be able to not be able to provide a service or food for anybody. And nobody wanted to touch us. Nobody wanted us near them. And it was a bizarre thing. So I suppose that's where the thought process of mine changed dramatically, in understanding that I'm more important than a job, than the work that I was doing, because at some point and I don't mean this horribly, but it's a reality. You're a number. You form a service, and when you're not needed, you sometimes are just pushed to the side. So COVID changed things dramatically for me, and had to regroup. I had to have major conversations with myself. I was angry for about 4 months, angry with the world. Didn't want to do anything. I would assume that I was a little bit depressed, if I have to be honest with myself. And I had to take the time to understand where I was mentally, and it was devastating. Look, around every corner there's an angel, and I had some people that looked after me very nicely, and with losing the job and with having to regroup, my life changed for the better for a little while, and got a fantastic job at a fantastic hotel group. Love what I'm doing, love the people I'm working for, and started a job 3 months later. Ended up coming up in hospital, fighting for my life. And then that started it. It's an emotional thing to talk about, because I knew that it was time was up, eh? And why I made it, I don't know, but I've had to think about that as well and realize there's a lot of good things ahead for me. And that started a couple of you start a new job, and all of a sudden for a month you've been at work for 3 months, and for a month you can't work. You come back broken. You're not the person that you were, and you're fighting every single day to come right physically. But what that does to your mind, having been a healthy, when I say healthy, I mean strong enough person mentally and physically, and to all of a sudden have none of that behind you anymore, you're fighting now. Got through that, thought everything's okay. A couple more months of devastation. I ended up getting shingles from the vaccine and from the COVID experience, which was another story that wasn't cool. I got flu, and then I got COVID again. I was in hospital, and I just didn't, in my mind, I was fighting every day. There was a smile on my face, but inside it was, why is this happening? What have I done? What have I done to deserve this? And how am I going to get through it? More importantly, stop worrying about why and what, but how are we going to make this? And I started forging a way through by myself. I thought it's cool. I don't need any help, because I'm a strong guy. I'm mentally, there's nothing wrong with me. I'm okay, but I'm not. And had a bit of a setback at home again. My beautiful woman, Shannon, had to have a kidney removed, and that was like, oh, just another thing that we had to fight in the household about. And then thought, okay, cool, nothing more can happen. This year is over and we've had enough trauma and everything. And in November, my life was, I thought I was hitting a beautiful trajectory again. And on my way to judge for the first time as a fully fledged judge at the Culinary World Cup, I had a trip planned afterwards, only to be told that 3 weeks before the trip, we're going to crack your chest open and we're going to pull your heart out and we have to do some surgery. And that was possibly the lowest that I've ever been at. And I had to start fighting hard there to come right from that. It was, the doctor was telling me that depression is a huge side effect of this operation. And I said, there's no way. It's not going to happen to me. I'm too good for this. Lo and behold, 2-3 weeks later, I found myself in a position where I had to start looking for help. And true to many South African males, and I'm calling this a male problem because I'm a man and I know from the people that I hang out with that we aren't easy to go and it's not easy for us to go look for help and try and get help to get through the situation because we think we're strong enough, but there was nothing more that I could do. My chips were down and my hands were down and I needed help. And I think for the people out there, that was possibly the most miraculous thing that could have happened to me is by just letting the defense down and saying, let somebody come into my life and help me sort out what's going on in my mind, because it's unfair for me to get into the moods and the depression and the snappiness to the people that are close to me. It's just so unfair for everybody around me that has fought so hard to get me well. And that's kind of where my journey ended. I was a proper chef. There was nothing to bother me until the life handed me some serious smacks.
Sure, chef. That's quite a journey you've been on. Well, one thing we can say is we're really grateful that you have pulled through, and actually that you know you're vulnerable and you've been able to overcome all these challenges. I mean, that's an amazing story. I've actually got goosebumps listening to you, but thank you for sharing that. Maybe if I could just ask just a few things. You know, mental well-being, it is a sensitive topic, and often we don't like to talk about it. And I think it's so nice that, you know, you're actually sharing your story, and it's actually okay. You know, if you do need help, it's okay to go out there and reach out for some help. If I can ask you, you've been in the hospitality industry for many years and you're highly respected. You are well known in the chefing fraternity. How do you manage your work-life balance? You know, it's very demanding and can be very stressful. Currently, now that you sort of back on track.
For me now, I've got a fantastic job that allows me a life balance, and I still to the more on the work side, because I suppose that's what I've been programmed to do my whole life. But I think if I do look back in my career, I so wish that I'd have just spent a little bit more on myself and my family, because there were so many things that I allowed to not be okay by just trying to think that I was all right doing what I was doing, trying to forge my way through the career. And to be honest, I suppose it doesn't help. The industry doesn't help us. It's a bit taxing. And I think if there's anything I could do going forward, I would like to be a protagonist on changing the way things are happening in our kitchens and how they used to happen. And I know a lot of changes made since the last 30 years. But we still seem to be a little bit bound by our work more than our private life. And I suppose anything I could just say to anybody, work hard when you're working, and you need to switch off, switch your emails off, switch up your WhatsApp groups. When you're off, I would almost say find a hobby that has got nothing to do with food, nothing to do with the industry. Don't watch MasterChef. Don't watch anything, because these kind of things get the anxiety levels flowing again. And you find yourself off work or not at work, and you end up watching Hell's Kitchen. And that's what I used to do. I used to watch all the things no time for myself, as in myself away from my career. Everything I did was national team. It was watching Hell's Kitchen, watching MasterChef, watching celebrity chefs, whatever it was, just being always part of the world of cooking. And if there's one bit of advice I can give anybody, don't do that. Get yourself away from it. Go and watch paint dry if that's what calms you down, rather than just you've got to release that anxiety that work gives you every day, because our jobs and our lives are full of angst.
Yeah, I know one thing I like to do is go and dig in my garden.
Yeah, I'm not going to push it that far. I'm not proud of myself.
My garden is my release on stress. Just time out and forget about everything. So Chef, what is your advice to Chef or a person with a difficult time in the hospitality industry? How do you uplift them?
I think in the kitchen, we should be a little bit more empathetic as head chefs and leaders and mentors. On the coalface, we have to be more empathetic. We have to start understanding that people have got problems, people have got lives, and lives are a lot more complicated than they used to be. We need to be the ones to drive the mental change. We need to be the ones to be the mentors within the mental framework. And more to that, what I would suggest and what has worked very, very well for me in the recent past is, whether you can see somebody or not, as in a therapist or a counselor, that's very important. More important is to get involved in a support group that is about what you're going through. So I found I went onto a heart bypass support group to understand the pains that I'm still feeling are 5 months after my operation, and to see if it's normal. You need to see that you are normal. And more importantly, within these groups, and it's horrible to say this, but you're going to find that there are people that are a lot worse off than you. And that has given me a complete different perception of the way I'm feeling. I was feeling sorry for myself, and I was feeling sorry. Why did I have this operation? Why did I have this operation? Why has my life changed so dramatically, physically and mentally, because of the problems that it gave me? But when I went onto the support group to understand people that have gone through this very thing that I went through, it helped me heal myself a lot quicker, because I realized that, man, I've had a magnificent surgeon. I've had a magnificent recovery period, and I'm actually in very good shape with a few niggles.
Yeah, sure. Okay. So thanks, Chef, for that. That's very wise advice. So just a reflection on post-COVID. Now that COVID has disappeared, are you finding there's still chefs that are struggling out there? And is there much support for those chefs or kitchens as they sort of getting back to some normality? I mean, now we know that we've got other problems in the country with the economy and load shedding. But, you know, what support is there out there for those kitchens?
I unfortunately think, just like everything that happens in life, is we took a huge knock, and I think our industry, like a lot of others, but our industry, for one, where we believed we were untouchable from any kind of pandemic, any epidemic, anything that would hit the world would never affect us chefs, and it smashed our career or our industry. And I think a lot of guys are still reeling from that, and it's only a year and a half since the major part of COVID. But there's still a lot of hurt happening out there, and I don't think enough has been done to allow us the opportunity to understand what we've been through, because it's not necessarily what we've been through; it's been what our close loved ones have been through, and people close to us that have passed away or been heavily affected, losing businesses, losing houses, losing families. I don't think that we've come through this properly, and I think not enough has been done, to be honest. And I would like to see a lot more reflection, a lot more empathy, and a lot more support going forward within our industry. From even if it's as simple as a Facebook support group where people can just drop their stories, not judged for what they're asking about, but more being supported by people that have gone through the same problems, to understand that you are okay not to be okay, but don't be not okay for too long.
Reach out for some help.
Exactly, yeah.
Very wise words, thank you. So, you know that we drive this Fair Kitchens movement, Chef Trevor, promoting work-life balance and encouraging healthy work habits within a team. How has this changed your perception of how a kitchen runs, or has it changed your perception?
Well, considering that I've personally been affected by many things in the last couple of months, the Fair Kitchen program that you guys have set up is, for me, is almost a no-brainer to have out in every kitchen. Posters need, we've put posters up in all of our kitchens within City Lodge Group, hoping that some people would anonymously, as it is, just not have to reach out to their supervisors or their bosses, but just quietly go when they get home. They've had a few tears about whatever has been, because life has been really hectic in the last 2 years for everybody. Just have an opportunity to phone this toll-free number and have someone in the end of the line that is not personally attached to your story, but to listen to you and give you some kind of advice that is not within and it's more without, so that you can have a... thought process. And I think the kitchen is underutilized. I think somehow we need to be able to get a drive going to make this our industry support group. And I don't, sorry, it can't be a support group because we're phoning people and we are, yeah. But it needs to be the support that our industry needs, if I can put it that way.
Okay, great. And Chef, is there still space for arrogance in those teams? Or do you think that's changing?
I think there is still a little bit of arrogance around, but I think that humility has taken over that, because we're not king of our castle anymore. You know what I mean? We've had to eat a bit of humble pie, and it's sorry to say, it's very bitter. And those that have come out of this arrogant, I'm sorry for you. I think that you need to take a step back, and you just need to understand that life is short, eh? Life is within an instant is gone. There's no time for arrogance. We need to be here for everybody. We need to be supporting everybody. Everybody should be working together to reap this industry and rebuild our world that we were so passionate about and loved so much.
So, Chef, I think we sort of coming up for time. So if I could just ask you, do you have two top tips that you do every day to ensure you have a great day in the kitchen with your team?
Like usual, and if my boss is listening, she'll be laughing now because I don't have two, I've got three. I've got to be extra always. My first one is find time to smile every day. If it's only just to make your face look better, that's the only reason to smile. Smiling makes the world go round, and it's this cliche, and a lot of these things are cliche that I'm saying, but now that I've taken them on board, smiling a little bit more authentically, it does a lot for your everything about your body. It gets the smile just makes everybody else around you smile as well. Appreciate everything about your life, good or bad. Because the bad will pass. The bad will pass, and the good will always overcome if you allow it to overcome. Don't get harped down on the negatives. Appreciate the fact that you can wake up today and breathe and love the people around you. Those people that love you, love them back. And the third thing is a little bit flippant, but it's enjoy music. When Katy Perry was on, I was bopping a little bit. Enjoy music. Sing and dance like nobody's watching you at least once a day. At least once a day. If you can't dance, it doesn't matter. I can't dance, but I try and slip a move every here and there. And those three things in life are important. At least love the people around you. It's over in a flash.
Yeah, those are lovely. I love your tips. Those are really great. And so simple to do every single day. So... all right, so I think we're going to just check on the poll and see if there's any questions. So I'm not sure if anyone's typed any questions into the chat box. So no questions in the chat box, Chef Mary. Just one question here from Chef Mabuping. Hi, Chef Trevor. How important is it to have a support system?
It's vital. It's absolutely vital. We think that we're stronger than we are. We're not. We need to find solace in the people that are close to us. Those people that are close to us are the ones that are going to drive us through every kind of problem we have in our life, whether it takes a day or it takes a week. And don't exclude yourself from your close ones. Support your family, whether it's friends, genuine, authentic friends, not a group of a whole lot of million people. You need the right people around you that fit your personality to allow you to have a good day and a bad day. There's a rule in my house that if you allow to have a bad day, go and lie in the embryonic position, go mope, go cry as much as you want, switch the light off, leave everybody alone. But tomorrow you wake up and you show up, you make your bed, you dress, and you come back and you've dealt with it. Try not to allow that day to last too long. There are moments where it might take a little bit longer, but use those people around you. Phone that friend that is happy to listen to you and not to judge you, and not to have to always listen with the intent to hear, not to give advice or to answer.
I think sometimes that's what we don't do enough of.
Yeah.
Just listen. Yeah. All right. Are there any more questions?
No, sure.
Okay. So if I could ask everybody to just go over to the poll, there's just two questions there that I would like to ask. And which hospitality channel do you work for? If you could just choose independent restaurants, deli retail, catering, hotel and conference, or other. If you wouldn't mind just putting that into the poll. We're just waiting for some feedback. Okay, which hospitality channel do you work for? Independent, restaurant, deli, catering, hotel, concert, or other?
Sorry about that. I'm back.
No problem.
Okay.
Okay, great. So the poll has come in. Great. So Chef Trevor, we've got quite a cross-section of people on the line today. We've got some in delis, catering, hotel and conference, and then other. So that's really nice. So what you've chatted about, you know, it's applicable all right across our hospitality industry. I think we all face similar challenges in the industry. You know, we all might work for a different establishment, but they're all the same sort of challenges. All right, so moving on to the second poll. Are your chefs or staff in the kitchen aware of the Fair Kitchen's toll-free helpline? It's just a yes or a no question. Okay, we're just waiting for the poll to come in. Great. Okay, so this is really great. We've actually got 73% that are not aware of the Fair Kitchen's toll-free helpline, so that's really great. So if I could share with you today, there is a handout, and on there is the Fair Kitchen's toll-free helpline, which is available 24/7. We use SADAG, the South African Depression and Anxiety Group. They actually manage it for us. and there are professional counselors on there to guide you and to help you should you need to reach out for any advice or any help. So what I'm going to ask you today is, for those of you that are not aware of it, please, if you wouldn't mind printing out that handout, and it would be really great if you could put it on your notice board to share with everyone. And then there's a toll-free line on that, which is on there, 0800006333. So you might want to put that in your phone as well to share with anybody that might be in need.
So can I just add something to that? It's more important than just putting it up on the notice board or somewhere in the kitchen. Talk to your staff about it. Even if you don't know if they've got problems or not, just mention to them every week, every second week, whatever it is. Guys, if you're feeling not okay, give this number a shout, because the more we allow people to understand that it is okay not to be okay, the more opportunity we're going to be able to help people.
Thank you for that. Perhaps it always becomes a something on your agenda when you have your kitchen meetings or staff meetings.
Exactly.
It's always just on the agenda, and it's there for staff to use. It's completely free and run by a professional team as well, and completely confidential as well. All right, so just in terms of our Fair Kitchens movement, promoting your work-life balance and encouraging healthy work habits, if any of you want to know more about Fair Kitchens, you can visit fairkitchens.com, and we also have a lot on our website, ufs.com as well. There's a lot of information there. Are there any more questions, Cass?
I see there's two more.
Okay.
So there's one here from Susan. Do you think it was tougher for senior members of hospitality industry or junior?
I'm assuming that she's asking COVID about really. COVID, whether it was tougher on, I would assume that's the question. And I'd like to think that it was even tough on both, eh?
I think it affected everybody in the hospitality industry. And then there's one more question. Sorry, you're breaking up there.
No, who's? There's a question on International Chefs Day. Reach out to the program. I'm an expat chef in West Africa, South Africa, but my teams are Nigerian and Ghanaian. I would assume that's how could we reach out to the Fair Kitchens program?
Well, so you could go and visit fairkitchens.com, because it is a global movement as well. So I'd maybe suggest that. Otherwise, we can take your name and we can contact you afterwards and see how we can help you. All right. We've got a lot of posts on Instagram, LinkedIn, Facebook, and Fair Kitchens. Thanks for that, Chef Pinky. Right. Okay, so just on closing, I think we'll need to close off now. I know, Chef Trevor, you've got so much to share and so much knowledge, and I'd just like to say thank you so much. Thank you for being open. Thank you for being vulnerable and having a nice open conversation and a nice discussion. And I think really there's a lot of life lessons to be learned out of, you know, and a lot of wise words, you know, out of what you've said. And thank you for those helpful guidelines. And guys, just remember, it's okay to not be okay. Reach out, don't be scared. If you need help, reach out to somebody to help you that you're comfortable with. And then just lastly, I have an Instagram handle, Chef Worthington Mary, and Chef Trevor is Trevor Boyd 999, if you would like to follow us on Instagram. And then thank you very much, everybody. Have an awesome day. and we look forward to seeing you at the next webinar. Thank you so much. Goodbye.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for listening.
Thank you so much. Bye.